Aloha. Good morning to our friends joining us from Indonesia and neighboring countries. Good afternoon to those joining in from Hawaii, and good evening to those on the mainland US. Welcome to the eighth session of the Adapting to COVID-19 Indonesia, United States, and the Indo-Pacific Virtual Forum Series, e-commerce and innovation, held with support from the US Embassy Jakarta and in partnership with the Center for Strategic and International Studies, Indonesia. This nine-part virtual series addresses broad cross-cutting issues that impact both countries, emerging security issues, COVID-19, regional and bilateral trade and investment, and democracy and civil society. It features American and Indonesian perspectives and experts with diverse yet complementary backgrounds to examine the trajectory of U.S.-Indonesia relations in the new normal. My name is Rob York, Director for Regional Affairs at the Pacific Forum International. Please note that this session features simultaneous interpretation. You may access the English or Bahasa Indonesia channels using the globe icon in the bottom right portion of your screen. Our seventh and most recent session on August 23rd concerned gender, diversity, and empowerment during COVID-19. Key findings from the meeting on this highly complex topic included: women have borne the brunt of the economic, social, and familial effects of the COVID-19 pandemic worldwide. It is projected that as many as 1 in 4 women in the US who left the workforce due to COVID-19 will not return to work. Gender-based violence, or GBV, and domestic violence are pandemics within the COVID-19 pandemic, particularly affecting minority groups and communities with pre-existing vulnerabilities, including many within the LGBTQIA+ community. In Indonesia, there was a 79% increase in reported cases of GBV from 2019 to 2020. COVID-19's uneven effects are acutely felt among minority groups and communities with pre-existing vulnerabilities. One study revealed 58% of transgender individuals in Indonesia recorded a loss of income as a result of the pandemic, and only 27% were receiving government support. Given these heightened challenges and often disproportionately negative gendered impacts, the pandemic poses a transformative opportunity to build a safer, more secure post-pandemic global society. The full key findings are available on our website at the link appearing on your screen. Edited videos in English and Indonesian from previous sessions in this series are available on Pacific Forum's YouTube channel. Others, including videos from sessions 6 and 7, are forthcoming. Today's session will focus on opportunities for cooperation between the United States and Indonesia in innovation and e-commerce. Indonesia is poised to become a regional hub for innovation with the world's fourth largest population, more than 40% of whom are under 25. Several decacorns have risen in Indonesia, including a hail riding app cum service mediator hub, Gojek, and the bustling online marketplaces Tokopedia and Bukalapak. During COVID-19 lockdowns, these tech companies provided a robust, interlinked digital service economy, facilitating the transition of traditional businesses to digital operations. The United States remains a global leader in innovation and technology. Many companies in Silicon Valley, such as Google, Tesla, and Uber, rely on young talent from around the world. However, the United States is losing its status as an attractive destination for young talent due to tighter immigration restrictions. Indonesia's young population and rapidly growing economy offers an opportunity for the United States to expand its market and create a new generation of Indonesian innovators. This session will explore the merits of creating new opportunities for Indonesian students to study in the United States and generate new ideas for technology and innovation, as well as how policies that encourage innovation can help both economies. Please note that remarks made in today's program are on the record, and a video and audio recording of this session will be made available on Pacific Forum's website and YouTube channel in the future. The event will also be live streamed to the CSIS Indonesia YouTube channel. Also, a reminder to all of our speakers today, please speak slowly and clearly for the interpreters. During the Q&A session, participants will be allowed to unmute their mics to ask questions and give feedback, as well as ask questions in the Q&A box. Participants' cameras are disabled throughout the session. I'd now like to introduce Leo Jilk, Assistant Cultural Affairs Officer at the U.S. Embassy Jakarta, to give some brief welcome remarks. Leo?
Thank you very much, Rob, and good morning, everyone. My name is Leo Jilk. I'm the Assistant Cultural Attaché at our Public Affairs Office at U.S. Embassy Jakarta. I manage the professional exchanges that we manage here in Indonesia, as well as our cultural and educational programs in collaboration with our Indonesian counterparts. We're very happy to present this morning a webinar about the future of digital economy in a world that is adjusting to and recovering from a global pandemic. The pandemic has, of course, greatly changed the economic landscape due to restrictions on work conditions and travel, the requirement to distance socially and to work from home, which we still observe at least part-time here at our embassy in Indonesia. So many businesses have been forced to rethink their model to accommodate these new conditions. And the digital world, as a result, has become a larger and larger part of the business world globally. The potential of digital economy is incredible, especially in Indonesia, where it so happens that we have the world's fourth largest population, which is described as having a population bonus, meaning that 40% of the Indonesian population is under the age of 25. Many leaders of the digital economy, including some who have achieved Decacorn status, arose here in Indonesia, including GoTo, the merger of Gojek and Tokopedia, whom we're very happy to have with us here this morning. During COVID-19 lockdowns, tech companies like GoTo and many others, of course, have continued to provide a robust interlinked digital service ecosystem, which helps to facilitate the transition of a traditional business model to digital operations. On the other side of the ocean, the US continues to lead innovation and technology, with innovative Silicon Valley companies continuing to improve business practice and norms in the digital marketplaces. Many tech companies in Indonesia and the US began through entrepreneurship as startups, and the potential for innovative collaboration between our two countries is certainly enormous and something that we hope to explore and continue to explore in the future. Questions we now face are, which aspects of the digital economy have the most potential, and what partnerships can we forge to collaborate more successfully around the world? Perhaps most importantly, how do we ensure that as many people as possible, those people from rural communities, grassroots organizations, and people from all backgrounds, genders, and groups participate in this transition? As our United States President Joe Biden said in a joint statement with G7 leaders earlier this fall, we're all committed to leveling up our economies so that no geographic region or person, irrespective of gender or ethnicity, is left behind. We will champion open economies and societies, promote global economic resilience, harness the digital economy with data-free flow with trust, cooperate on a modernized, freer and fairer rules-based multilateral trading system that reflects our values and delivers balanced growth. So to discuss this and many other aspects of the digital economy today, we thank Dr. Aisha Khanna from Auto AI, Astrid Kusumarwardani from GoTo, and Leah from Remote Skill Academy for sharing their perspectives and their expertise with us. Thank you once again also to Fitriani from CSIS for moderating this morning's discussion, and of course, to our partners at Pacific Forum. We hope you enjoy the session. Don't hesitate to ask a lot of questions and have a great discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Leo. I will now hand over the mic to Fitriani, researcher at CSIS Indonesia, who will moderate the discussion and Q&A. Fitriani, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Rob. Thank you, Leo. It's always such a wonderful feeling to meet you again virtually and to continue the good relation we have. Now, we will do today's presentation, three presentations altogether, and then follow up by the Q&A discussion. This is a friendly reminder for the speaker to keep their presentation to 10 minutes so we can have ample time for question and discussion. The session is 90 minutes total, so please remember to speak slowly and clearly for the interpreters. As a reminder, participants may access the live interpretation feature using the globe icon located in the bottom right portion of the Zoom window. Note that participants are welcome to raise their virtual hand or submit questions in the Q&A box during presentation. So you can do that anytime before you forget, maybe later on. So in other words, you don't have to save them until the end. As being mentioned by Leo, today's presentation for our session on e-commerce and innovation are Ayesha Khanna, co-founder and CEO of Ado AI, Aulia Halimatusadiyah, or Leah, Chief Marketing Officer at Remote Skills Academy Indonesia. Last but not least, Siti Astrid Kusumawardani, Vice President of Public Affairs at GoToGrow Group. Hello, everybody. I hope everyone are doing well today in this unprecedented time that ongoing for 2 years almost. Now, I will start I will give the first opportunity to our first speaker, Dr. Ayesha Khanna, the co-founder and CEO of Ado AI. Ado AI is an artificial intelligence solution firm and incubator. She has been a strategic advisor on artificial intelligence, smart cities, and fintech to leading corporation and government. Dr. Khanna served on the board of Infocom Media Development Authority, or IMDA, the Singapore government's agency that develops and regulates its world-class vision and technology sector to drive the country digital economy and power its smart nation. Dr. Khanna is also a member of the World Economic Forum Global Future Council, a community of international experts who provide thought leadership on the impact and governance of emerging technologies such as artificial intelligence. Dr. Khanna, the screen is yours.
Thank you so much. It's such a pleasure to be here today. I will speak about a couple of trends that I think are very important for global partnerships. So the first thing is that let's go right down to the individual. More than companies, let's look at individuals who are working with each other across the world, whether it's Indonesia, the US, Brazil, Africa. Remote work is one of the biggest trends in terms of acceptance and in terms of a desire to work in meaningful ways from wherever you are. And the great resignation that we see in the US is not only in the US, actually. People all over the world are looking for opportunities to work for companies that they believe in, wherever they may be from. And immediately, this gives us the opportunity for collaboration and greater linkages between ASEAN and the United States, North America, European Union, to create an environment in which it is very easy to work with people who are from each other's countries in teams. There is a global talent crunch across the world, especially in emerging sectors such as artificial intelligence, data science, robotics, and emerging technologies like quantum computing and crypto and blockchain. The demand is so high with new companies in Silicon Valley and New York looking for talent wherever they can find it. And in this respect, countries like Indonesia, whose have a young, thriving population. And my company, we also have one of the best machine learning engineers who's a woman outside Jakarta, who is a huge boost to our team in Singapore and South Asia. So there are great universities and an opportunity for Indonesian talent to capitalize on this global demand, specifically also in the US. At the same time, Indonesian companies who have not had the experience of scaling very fast or of knowing how to raise venture capital funds, we see that they go to Y Combinator and Silicon Valley. They work with Union Square Ventures. They take courses on Coursera. All of these are American companies that provide guidance because they have been there before. So I think that there is an opportunity, not for a one-way exchange, which used to be that Asia was the back office for America. That's not the case anymore. That's not the way we position ourselves in Asia now. Not only do Americans work with team members who are Indonesians, but now Indonesians hire Americans, regardless of whether they're in Portland or they're in Seattle or they're in New York, because there is so much value from the complementary skills that both these countries and the talent bring to each other. And the millennials and the global cosmopolitans are exactly the same. I know, because even though I'm headquartered, my firm in Singapore, we work with very large banks and we'll start with a ministry in Indonesia. We also work with two of the largest companies in the world based in the US. And we find that remote teams that are diverse, inclusive, diverse in gender, ethnicity, nationality, that is what prepares you for a global customer base. So that's the first thing I'd like to talk about, which is how do individuals in both countries take advantage of this interconnectedness? The second thing I'd like to talk about is the concept of smart cities. So my PhD is in smart cities. We work on the digital economy of the world. And this notion that cities must collaborate with each other. As much as we see this incredible value of federal governments pushing and encouraging collaboration, we are seeing mayors of different cities come up and support these endeavors by actively reaching out. So if you look at where crypto is really rising, it's in Miami. And the mayor of Miami is welcoming everyone from all cities in the US and saying, come and have startups here. He just actually tweeted to Elon Musk, who said he wanted to start a university in Texas. And the mayor of Miami replied to his tweet and said, no, come and set it up in Miami. Let's make it work. And so for Jakarta, for all the cities in Indonesia, beyond the federal government, the mayors of these cities can take this opportunity to directly reach out and have city-to-city connectivity. Whether that city believes in tourism, sustainable tourism, in electrification, in robotics, in crypto, in artificial intelligence, cities are beginning to become hubs of talent. And this will be so important, not just for the countries, but for cities. Imagine a Jakarta to Miami access, or any other city that believes in a similar technology. And these digital economic linkages are critical to capitalize early in the game. So as attractive as Indonesian cities are, American cities are very attractive as well. So the ones as a first mover advantage that I think now is the time to capitalize on. And that is very, very important. The third thing I would like to talk about is the importance of educational linkages. So I spoke about remote teams before. I'm from Asia. I grew up in Asia. And then I went and you know, came back to Asia after spending 20 years in the United States. From Boston to New York, everything that I learned on Wall Street, I brought back to Asia and set up this company here. There is no substitute for going to each other's countries. But again, the old way of doing this has been that we only have Asians go to America. But we need Indonesians to also welcome Americans to study in universities in Indonesia so that they can actually begin to capitalize on the knowledge of emerging markets that is so necessary. Come and feel the culture. Come and understand why Indonesia is leapfrogging over every other country with some of their innovative ideas, with the entrepreneurial spirit. This can only be learned by having this student exchange. And while we've had student exchanges between Europeans and Americans, the Asian American access is only now beginning to develop. So I would encourage these three things, which are smart city opportunities for digital and student exchanges. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your very inspirational and very thoughtful presentation. On a 3-point, how would individual benefit from the digital economy? The second was on the smart city connection. And the third is the building remote team that would build something greater that connects cities as well. I think it is very, very beneficial if we can build more and more connection. And talent is one of the way. Next, we will go to Ms. Aulia Halimatu Sadiah, or Lia, the CMO of Remote Skill Academy Indonesia. It's an impact-focused education program to empower Indonesians to reskill with remote work skill, such as virtual assistant, digital marketing, etc., to build successful remote career, serve global client from Indonesia, to be able to earn better living and connect with the community on the same journey. It's so interesting. And I think many of the participants here want to hear more in terms of how Indonesia and perhaps talent from the global South and Southeast Asia, as well as the wider Indo-Pacific, can be entering this platform to increase their skill and work globally. It's Lia, the screen is yours.
Thank you so much, Fitri. Thank you so much, everyone, for having me. I'm gonna share my screen. All right, okay. So my name is Lia. So I'm the CMO of Remote Skills Academy Indonesia. And I live in Bali since the pandemic. So talking about adapting to COVID-19, so I am adapting. So exactly in March 2020, I see the trend outside Indonesia where, you know, like a lot of lockdowns. And I just said that, okay, I couldn't have a lockdown in Jakarta. So I flew to Bali thinking that it would just gonna be 2 weeks. Of course, it's already 2 years now. So Remote Skills Academy. So Remote Skills Academy is an impact-focused education program. So basically, the way we started in 2020, so started by my good friend Lavinia. She's running Live It in Bali, Indonesia. And Live It thinks that they saw a lot of expats coming to Bali and with all their skills, but then you know, there's a gap between the experts, expertise and the locals. And they simply just want to bridge that at first, and then pandemic happens, right? So it's such a great opportunity to, because in Bali, as we know, 90%, 85% to 90% people working in tourism industry. So naturally, when COVID hits, the pandemic hits, there's no tourists and most of them lose their job. But in the same time, the technology world is picking up, right? All this e-commerce and everything about technology are picking up. And of course, they need talents to, you know, workforce to help them. And this is where we come, where we want to basically help Indonesian youth to learn something new, to reskill, to upskill, and use that to serve clients not only in Bali, but also in Jakarta or in the world. The way we do it, we start with bridging. So if anyone, if the students couldn't speak English yet and maybe couldn't use the laptop yet, we kind of have the course to for that at first, right? But then normally we only do the courses. We offer a lot of courses that I will explain later, but we start with virtual assistants. So virtual assistants, online business manager, project management, digital marketing, SEO, and yeah, many more. And then we aim to accelerate. So after they come out of the classroom, and then we have them in a community, we do group mentoring, we do career coaching, and then jobs matching. So these some of our programs. The first is the recorded program. The first is live program. So we do live like this, the Zoom program through the first is virtual assistants. And then, yeah, basically everything around remote work, right? So remote work was quite new when we start. But then Livit, Lavinia, my partner, has been doing it for almost 10 years. So they're actually very have the expertise to share, right? And then after live programs, we are thinking that we want to scale the program. So that's why we record the live program. And then we have our own learning platform that the people can learn at their own pace, at their own time. And then we start experimenting with hybrid. So half of the program is done live, and then the other half is through the recorded. And I think it was quite good because the rating of the satisfaction of the students are not reduced. So we are trying to do more of the hybrid. Also, we are trying shorter masterclass like ads. And then maybe weekend courses. So we just kind of, I guess because my background was is from startup industry. So I kind of like to experiment with things and see whatever works with our students at the moment. Aside from the programs that we did also a community program where we kind of update people of what's going on, you know, cryptocurrency and then how to build business from the States. Ari is actually Balinese that moved to the US and start her own business and then share again, you know, how give back to the community here and sharing how she did that. And then we also have a speaker who used to be a personal assistant, and then worked from Bali. And then now, after 2 years, she already in Jakarta working as an executive director. So we kind of want to inspire more people and tell them that education really changed lives. Right now at Remote Skills Academy, since last year, we already done 15 courses, 300 plus participants, students, and 8.9 satisfaction ratings. And we are really happy with that. This is some of the stories from our academy. Putu, the first story, Putu, he used to work as a waiter in Bali. Of course, commute like 1 hour for work, and then he lost his job, and then he joined us learning, I guess it's virtual assistant or project management course with us, and then in the time of 3-4 months, while joining the community, he got a recommendation to apply in a Singapore company, and then he got the job, and also now He worked for two companies actually, freelancing. One is Singaporean company and from German. So, you know, he's starting to increase his income to three times before, right? So, yeah, I think I'm very proud of him because he was very timid, very shy, but then after the course, after hanging out with more friends in remote workers community, he become more confident and now can serve global clients. We also have Salma, who's a mom of two, and then she needs to stay at home. But now after, you know, learning how to do it, she can serve her clients as well, global clients from home, while taking care of her kids. So I believe she only worked four hours a day or something like that. So she has more time for the family. And then we have Satria, who has cancer and then trying to recover from cancer. And while in the same time, upskill himself, you know, with digital marketing and video editing skill. And then now he already, you know, recovered fully free from cancer and has a new career in digital marketing with us. So this is what we're trying to do next, is to kind of intentionally, I mean, the stories that I told you guys was really like naturally evolving, but now we want to be more intentional in shaping our alumni. So we do group coaching, we do upskill classes like low code, you know, you have a coding master classes and one-on-one coaching, really see their challenges. And I can tell you, Fitri, in the discussion, what some of their challenges that they face, right? And also try to have jobs matching and opportunity matching for them as well. So yeah, if you are interested to know more or would like to support Indonesian youth to reskill and upskill, you can go to our website, remoteskills.academy. Thank you so much. Back to you, Fitri.
Thank you so much, Leah. It's it is very inspirational to learn how reskilling and upskilling, especially in the crucial moment of the pandemic, really helps save life and especially still maintain the lifestyle and you know, health and sanity. And I think it is really really eye-opener how education enables and how there's a remote opportunity that can be explored further. And I think especially from the young population of Indonesia, we can contribute more to the world. So I thank you so much for your work.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next, last but not least, we have with us Ms. Siti Astrid Kusumawardani, the Vice President of Public Affairs of GoTo Group, Southeast Asia leading technology group and a pioneer of the integrated super app and ecosystem model. As you all know, perhaps the name that perhaps a daily life brand for you that is on-demand provider of Gojek, e-commerce Tokopedia, and payment as well as financial services provider GoTo Financial. Astrid herself leads policy advocacy and stakeholder engagement in line with GoTo Group mission for empowering progress and driving social impact. She builds support with key stakeholders in Indonesia and initiate new programs and partnerships to support the million driver partners, small business owners and merchants, as well as community groups in the GoTo ecosystem. Astrid, the screen is yours.
Thanks again, Fitri, Pacific Forum, also my fellow presenters. Really interesting to look at how the different players, yeah, at this very challenging time deal with innovation, how we can get together to improve, you know, the situation, especially for people who are affected by the pandemic, including, you know, remote workers or us as a digital talent, but also people who actually use the technology. So I think my presentation for the next 10 minutes will talk about how innovation plays out in Indonesia during COVID-19, especially from the lens of tech companies like GoTo. And also, what are the opportunities for collaboration with US talents or with global talents in growing ecosystems such as GoTo? Because we do need a lot of digital talents. We need a lot of, you know, engineers, product managers, data scientists, basically, you know, top talent, Silicon Valley talents, to be able to develop GoTo even more, because the impact of companies like GoTo, the impacts of digital platforms during COVID-19 is really significant, especially for the informal sector who dominates labor force in countries like Indonesia. So hopefully I'll be able to talk you through some of that and give you a bit of flavor of what GoTo Group does and then where the areas of collaboration are with talents from the United States, for example. Let's kick off. The GoTo Group has actually just been established as a group around May this year, but it consists of three different companies that have already existed in Indonesia since 10 years ago, or more than a decade ago. In fact, Gojek just had our 11th anniversary last week. So what is GoTo Group, right? GoTo Group is, you can think of it as an ecosystem that combines three different services. So we have an on-demand services called Gojek. This is where you get your ride hailing, you get your food delivery, you get express logistics, and you get anything you want to consume, such as content on the app, news on your app. So it's basically a super app for all on-demand services. And then we have financial services called GoTo Financial. So this is where you have payments, financial services, insurance, investments, anything you want to do on the app that has to do with your financial management, money management. GoTo Financial is the ecosystem for that. So that includes e-money, e-wallet, QR codes for e-payments, bill payments, and all kinds of suites of services. And then we have e-commerce, which is Tokopedia, as basically very much like, you know, your Amazon, your Alibaba. So if I can kind of find a US equivalent, this would be like Amazon, Uber, PayPal, all mixed into one. It's a massive, massive ecosystem that serves the Indonesian people. I'm sure a lot of the Indonesians in this call already use Gojek or Tokopedia, you know, more than once a day. Just to give you a scale of how big GoTo Group is, currently, you know, there's 100 million active users. So if you see Indonesia's population is 260 million, I would say half of them have downloaded, you know, one of our apps and used them. More than 22 billion of gross transaction value, making it one of the biggest in Indonesia and Southeast Asia. We have 11 million merchants. These are micro entrepreneurs. So they would be, you know, your mom and pop stores. They would be street hawkers or streets vendors scale. Only very, very little is our kind of enterprise scale. These are like your big fast food or chains. They make less than, you know, 4% of our ecosystem. A really good chunk of our merchants are small, medium businesses. And then, of course, we have the driver partners, 2 million of them. So these are kind of your delivery providers. These are the motorbike drivers or taxi or four-wheeler drivers who can transport people around, but they also deliver goods and logistics as well. So if you order something on Tokopedia, for example, you can order instant delivery and get within 2 hours of, if the radius applies, within 2 hours, you have your goods as an instant commerce experience. So that's just kind of how massive the ecosystem of GoTo is. Again, what you can do with it, this is not just consumers, we also have a lot of merchants, and pretty much from 7:30 a.m. till 9 p.m., you can live your life in the ecosystem. Before COVID, consumers would use our motorbike to get to work, and they would pay for coffee with GoPay scanned, you know, during their break. They would look at investments and maybe pay bill, buy gold, buy mutual funds on Tokopedia. And then order dinner before they get home on GoFood. And then when they get home, they can eat food and stream content from Tokopedia Play or from our video on demand called GoPlay. Same thing as merchants, like you can check your inventory, manage all your logistics, manage everything to do with your payments, reconciliation, all of that you can do within the apps. So for GoFood or food merchants, you have the GoFood app. for the Tokopedia merchants, you have the Tokopedia seller app. So that's where you manage all your stock keeping units and all your business transactions. So what have we done, right, during COVID? So as you can see, the ecosystem is massive. There's a lot of people depending on us. And so I'd like to talk you through what Gojek, Tokopedia, and GoTo Financial have done and what are the impacts we're seeing. So for Gojek, a bulk of our priority is to make sure our drivers are safe because they're the one at the front lines and they're the one who are delivering goods, they're delivering food, packages, while all of us have to be at home during lockdown. So they are the front liners, essentially, during when Indonesia pretty much can't function, especially in big cities like Jakarta. So what we've done since the outbreak of COVID-19, make sure that we accelerate all vaccinations for drivers, working with the government on this. We roll out health checkpoints all across Indonesia to make sure they know they get that temperature check, they get their masks and other health kits, they get their vehicle sanitized as well. There's a lot of awareness campaign just to make sure we fight misinformation out there so they understand why they need to be vaccinated. And of course, we have in-app support with telemedicine and information of where they can get tested, including if they get positive COVID-19, Gojek actually does provide support. So this is an income replacement scheme to make sure they still have a livelihood while they need to recover from COVID-19. Safety, really proud to see there's consumers also are safe if they do need to get out. Their checkpoints, they can make sure they sanitize their hands and check the temperature. But what's really interesting that even on the app, you can check the driver's status. So if they've been vaccinated, if they've been checked recently at a safety checkpoint, and if their vehicle has been cleaned, and then you can pretty much do contactless delivery and cashless payments as well. Same thing with hygiene, which is, make sure that food preparation is safe. There's lots of guidelines to make sure during this time, our small, medium-sized merchants know how to prepare food for customers and for drivers in a very safe manner. And what we've seen is actually really encouraging. You know, 2020 was really hard on Indonesia. I think that's the first time we've had an economic recession in 12 years. And so everything slumped, including, for the informal sector. Overnight, people get laid off. Overnight, people get, they leave their jobs or they get out of jobs. So 2020 was really tough on our partners, and we try to make sure they still have livelihood income opportunities, shifting from people transport to food transport, for example. But in 2021, we're seeing a trend of recovery. So we're actually seeing their incomes have improved this year compared to last year. And we're able to actually contribute to the GDP around 1.6%, which is pretty big, knowing that digital economy itself is about 3.5 to 4% of the economy. So if Gojek contributes 1.6% of that, that's pretty huge. This is a 60% improvement from where we were last year. So it's actually really good to see our partners still have income and that, they feel happy with their partnership with us and they feel like they have a safety net during this very difficult time because they're getting a lot of support from Gojek, like phone credit, health equipment, and vaccinations, and also support for their family, staple goods, and other types of financial support. Now, moving on to Tokopedia. Tokopedia is a really interesting story because, again, almost all of their merchants are small and medium sized. But during the pandemic, their transactions have actually increased. So if you look at 2020 numbers here from Jan to July, the amount of business owners who perform transaction is pretty much exponentially increased. And these are benefiting more women because they are owners of the stores in Tokopedia. And so as everything shifted online overnight, the trends of digitalization happened so quickly in 2020, you can see exactly how that translates to transactions in e-commerce and everything is happening on the online world. So that's really, really interesting to see that this increase in transactions have grown. And what's more interesting to see is where they have happened. So as you know, Indonesia is is huge, right? It's the biggest archipelago in the world. And it's very distributed. It's very wide. Logistics is always an issue. That's why it's hard for you to get high quality goods if you're outside of Java, if you're outside of Jakarta even. But with Tokopedia, you're able to get goods faster, you're able to get the same quality, and you're able to get it at the price that's affordable. And if you look at the sales, they happen in West Nusa Tenggara, which is in the kind of eastern region that's east of Bali. There are a lot of sales happening in central Sulawesi and south Sulawesi. So these are the hubs for economy in East Indonesia. So you just see like how e-commerce is distributing opportunities for growth and innovation away from not just the big cities like Jakarta, but all to the hubs towards east of Indonesia. Last but not least is GoToFinancial. Again, GoToFinancial is a really interesting story as well, because I would say it's a shortcut to financial inclusion. Usually you would have to have a, you know, a savings account, you have a credit card, and then you start investing, you buy your insurance, and you kind of have to like go through that steps. But in Indonesia, it's very difficult because banking is not common, cash is still king. You know, our financial inclusion rate is nowhere near 100%. It is getting higher and higher, around 60 plus, but it's nowhere like in, you know, like in the United States, for example, where everything is cashless. So a lot of people are still unbanked or underbanked, where they're not really using their savings account or their sharing savings account. But with GoPay, because it's on their phone, they can easily pay with their phone. They can top up their credit via non-bank channels, like your convenience stores. You can top up there, and then you have your credit, and you can transact online without a bank account. And so when we survey, we actually ask that, you know, the merchants and also consumers' first ever experience in the financial or cashless world is because of GoPay. And that's how they get included. And that's how they get more interested in banking. They get more interested in activities like mutual funds and on all these other different financial products. So yeah, we're very excited to see where this all go. I think I'm almost out of time. But yeah, all these innovations happening during COVID-19, right? Because we really, really don't have a choice but to innovate to make sure the millions of people who depend on us have a living. And to do that, yeah, we do need a lot of talent. We need a lot of workforce. We need the best of the best in the world to come in at Gojek, to go to Tokopedia and go to Financial, just to make sure we're rolling out the best product that would help everyone here during the COVID-19 pandemic. So yeah, I'd be happy to answer more questions later in our Q&A. Thank you. Back to you, Fitri.
Thank you so much, Astrid. It is really insightful how the impact of the pandemic that changed life globally, nationally, and even in the society level can go through a recovery and build back better through the work of tech innovation that is done with your example of the GoTo group and the businesses that is working under it, which is like Gojek, Tokopedia, and GoTo Financial. And I think it is interesting to learn about how this technological innovation enables an increased growth in areas that are traditionally slow in having digital transformation. So it's a really good example of connectivity increasing welfare. And I will stop myself there because I know we need to go proceed to the discussion. And now we have around 40 minutes for a discussion and Q&A. And you can have two options in asking the question by the Q&A box, making comments. If you're in our social media, you can write in the chat, and we have teams that will relay the question to the Zoom. You can also raise your hand, and we, if there's time, we will call you to speak up and ask your own question. I will go to the first question from Robert Bloom, directed to Dr. Khanna. Robert Bloom asked whether remote work diminished the attractiveness of city because we witnessed the real estate boom outside big cities as residents migrated out of due to COVID. For example, moving to Bali, and have the countryside life as connected with the cities. So how do you address this? I would ask the question for Leah also, so you have time to think. From Muhammad Karisma, I was wondering if remote work or your work, Leah, is applicable elsewhere in Indonesia, or whether, as you mentioned, you're living in Bali as a special case for remote learning initiative. What do you think that other regional cities need to have to increase their chance to be attractive enough for startup and technological innovation to work for community upskilling? And for Astrid, the question is, I know you shared this before, but perhaps you can also share with us again, what is the changes that go to built-in pandemic specifically that will further innovation, seeing the customer behavioral change as well. So I will give the first opportunity for Dr. Khanna to answer the question. Please.
Rabah, thank you for your question. And that's such a good point, that what we're seeing is this massive exodus towards the suburbs or towards cheaper cities where you can have more space and you can actually have higher quality of life. And the Great Resignation is pretty much sending this signal, the Great Resignation, which is this trend that people are resigning from their jobs in order to find more meaningful work, but also to be able to be given permission to do that work from wherever they want. So in a way, you are right. The traditional cities that are very expensive are going to suffer somewhat, but not too much, because the venture capitalists may be there when they get together, which there is not so much substitution for human-to-human interaction once in a while, these headquarters of major cities still remain in the cities. So the corporate headquarters remain in tier one cities. There is going to be talent influx to those cities, whether it is for client meetings, whether it is for hiring, whether it is for team offsites, or whether it is for venture capital and financial markets. On the other hand, it's more of a hub and spoke model where you know, they have various spokes in which the larger talent works. And what this means is not so much that the value of the fundamental value of the city will go down, which is the main gravitational force, but that these hubs will also start, these mini hubs or spokes will also start coming up. And I think we'll see a lot more people opting for this through remote work. And I think it's a very good sign, but I think it's a win-win for individuals. And it's a, it is a sad thing where those cities in the US or in Asia that have been struggling to provide high quality of life at reasonable prices will have to rethink the way they're attracting talent. So the war for talent will continue, not only between these mega cities, but also between these so-called second tier cities that are coming up. But I think for corporate headquarters, these very big hubs, these mega cities like London, like Mumbai, like Singapore, like Jakarta, they will continue to be very important.
Thank you so much for your answer, Dr. Khanna. I think it is very spot on. I agree with your answer. And as well as the model that you mentioned about the hub and spoke model, as well as how this this collaboration enables cities that perhaps never been heard before will enable talents to work from there. And I will give the opportunity to Leah to answer the question. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Fitri. Thank you, Muhammad Karisma. Is it replicable? Yes. I didn't mention, we started in Bali, but then our students coming from all over Indonesia. So we have a lot in Jakarta, we also have in Bandung, you know, and Jogja, and so it's kind of spread. So if you ask me, can we do the initiative anywhere else in Indonesia? The answer is yes. I guess even when you are in Majalengka, for example, or Brebes or wherever in Indonesia, but if you have a good, decent internet connection, which is that can be a discussion on its own, right? Because for example, these Zoom calls, we need like not super fast, but needs to be stable, right? So the question is, where is that place where the internet can be stable, right? And that's it, because everything else we can do online. And sometimes, yeah, I mean we proved to ourselves that for the past 1.5 years, for example, we haven't have any offline class yet at the Remote Skills Academy, and everything was okay, you know. So the interaction, the community interaction can be done online. Even I've done a lot of hiring online as well. So you know, learning and connecting to people can be done perfectly well online anywhere in the world, anywhere in Indonesia. In terms of, is it attractive enough for startups to recruit, for example, right? I guess it's a matter of PR. So like Miami, Dr. Aisha, you mentioned Miami, right? Like Miami Tech, and I've been thinking about Bali Tech as well. And it's a matter of, you know, like highlighting and showcasing. The mayor of Miami was so great in the way he promotes it, right? He used Twitter, and also he put a billboard that says, if you're coming to Miami, DM me, right? DM me. Are you a founder? DM me. So that kind of PR stunts. So if anywhere in Indonesia, for example, you're in Bandung or Jogja or Malang, for example, and you're the mayor of the city, and you can make that kind of, you know, public relation work and, you know, like thought leadership, building it, I think it will be interesting still for the startup founders to find the talents there. But of course, we need to also remember the foundation of it, which is the universities, right? And how we empower the universities and the whole ecosystem in the city to be ready for that. And I think that's another discussion of its own, and hopefully I can catch up again with you know, Ayesha and also Astrid to discuss more about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Leah. I will turn now to Astrid to give example of how technological tech innovation companies have helped the connectivities and digital transformation. And I want to learn more whether go to have this kind of, you know, how do you deal with the patchy internet outside Java, for example? And you, Astrid, brilliantly show us about the increase of connectivity in this eastern part of Indonesia that we know it was quite difficult. So maybe Astrid could share with us more of the go to, you know, lesson learned or tips or activities, please.
Yeah, thanks, Fitri. So when we talk about digital skills gap and go to, I mean, we're talking about different people, right? There's the drivers, there's merchants, there's consumers, and there's us, you know, who the digital talent who pretty much work to power go to. So maybe it's useful to just kind of think about the digital transformations that happen to each of them. For drivers, you know, at the beginning, Gojek started as a call center back in 2010. The app itself was launched in 2015, and then it got really big 2016, 17, and then you see how it is today. But before, it was very difficult to convince driver partners, who at the time we called Ojek Pangkalan, and the conventional Ojek drivers, to want to use to want to use smartphone. I mean, back in 2010, your smartphone is really very, you know, it's very basic, right? And at the time, it wasn't even a navigation or kind of the ride hailing that we see today. It's basically, I would call a call center, and the call center would call the driver, and then they would arrange, and then I'd get picked up somewhere. And then the price would be set, so I don't have to haggle as much. And so that saves a lot of trouble for me, right? But yeah, it took a while to then educate drivers about that this is an additional income opportunity for them. And then, yeah, it was painful, but it had to be done. You know, we did massive onboarding at one point. The app was launched, and then we had to re-educate all the drivers about how to use the app. This basically, you know, ranges from how to use Google Maps, how to read, you know, the different instructions, what are passwords? What's your one, you know, pins and one-time passwords? And then now you see all our drivers are very savvy. They're can manage their app. They know how to do the selfie verification. They can access the Gojek driver app. They can do like online learning. Some of them have signed up and pay for mutual funds with their GoPay wallet because it's linked. So it's just a massive amount of digital transformation just from being familiar and using the mobile app and navigating through that. And there's a lot of investment as well on our side to teach drivers via face-to-face learning, online learning. We have what we call Kopidarat or called Kopdar. So every single city where we operate, or the major cities where we operate, we have these meetings, and part of it is for capacity building and skills upgrading for drivers, training. So yeah, on the driver side, we see a massive amount of digital transformation. And as you can see, a lot of our drivers are high school educated. Some of them are university educated. Some are high school educated. Some are elementary schools educated. So it's varied. But they're all able to be super well-versed with technology and use it to get income for their livelihood. So that's how the digital transformation happened on their side. On the merchant side as well, it's a massive movement from what used to be offline selling. So very dependent on a footfall. So they would only sell to maybe 10 houses, you know, to the left and to the right. And now they're selling to people in the 25 kilometer radius. And that's huge, you know, market being open. But that's not enough, right? Because they need to know how to take good photography on the app. They need to know how to self-manage their promo. They need to know how to manage the inventory and the reporting at the end of the day, manage logistics. And so all of this are done continually, and it's through self-serve. So now all these merchants know how to, you know, update everything just on the app. And again, these are your very traditional sellers that you wouldn't think they'd be able to, you know, manage everything on the app so smoothly, because they come from a very offline world. For consumers, I think that digital transformation happened very naturally, especially now with COVID. Everything moved online. Everyone is very spoiled here in Indonesia because you have Gojek, GoPay, Tokopedia. You don't even have to leave your seat. You get everything delivered to your house, food, goods, you know, documents, everything. It's really insane the amount of reliance our consumers have on us for their daily life, me included. So I'm guilty of being very spoiled during this COVID pandemic because I can't go anywhere. So they all come here to the house. And for talent, yeah. So you can see with it's not just Gojek, right? We have other unicorns and we have other startups. And so the need for talent has shifted. So now, you know, there's a lot of need for digital talent, but not just digital as in sort of hard skills, yeah. You also need people who understand the user experience or the user interface. So these are your product managers, and they're not necessarily all technical background. They all have social skills background or social studies, because they know how the human mind or how the experience, you know, psychologically of what someone would feel when they interact with an app. You would need data scientists. You need really, really good researchers who are able to do qualitative and in-depth surveys with consumers, for example, to understand their pain points. So suddenly with all these tech companies, startups, you know, in Indonesia budding up, you have opened up a whole new area of the labor force that wasn't there 5-10 years ago. And so that's kind of shifted the entire need for the country to quickly fill in this gap, because there is a dearth of supply. We do need a lot of talent in that area. And so that's where I'm seeing the transformation, and especially Indonesia being the largest digital market in Southeast Asia, it'll be the biggest by 2030. So in the next, you know, eight years, you'd see a lot more digital talent coming into Indonesia or being developed, you know, internally as well within country, just because we need the volume of talent to support the digital economy.
Thank you so much, Astrid. Thank you, speaker, for your answer. I would now continue with the second set of questions. There is a question from Karen Budianta to Dr. Khanna. Karen would like to know more whether you can share with us the strategies for building the connection for smart city for cities that's not yet smart, I guess, if that's what you can say, like small cities that is not trying and not yet there, not tech advanced, like you were mentioning about London, New York, Miami, but how about the cities that Leah said, Mojokerto, Brojonegoro, all the small cities somewhere, and maybe in Cambodia, rural Cambodia, or rural Laos, for example, and how what's the trick? How do you do capacity building? How do you do the digitalization of the cities and enable them to be part of that hub and spoke model? Second question is to Leah. The question from Dandi Rafitrandi, asking, people talk a lot about digital skill and talent gap as it is increasingly important to for companies' competitiveness to get the right talents. Usually, the lack of the not equipped educational system is blamed for being too distant with the industry. What is your take on the issue, especially in ASEAN and in Indonesia? And how's your company strategy to deal with the gap if it exists? And perhaps this question will be open as well for Dr. Khanna, because she's working in artificial intelligence as well. Last but not least, the question for Astrid. To what extent does Gojek partnership system give way or leeway for Gojek in the effort of protecting the frontliner during the pandemic? I know you mentioned about the vaccination, the health, the support, and perhaps you can connect that with the effort of having them as the frontliner and expanding the business. There's a lot of questions to Ms. Astrid. Maybe I would team that question with a question from Aria Fernandez. It is, I don't know whether this is within your scope, but if you can answer, it'd be great. On the go-to response of to the 15% global minimum corporation tax formally endorsed in the G20 summit. That is probably a more advanced question in regards to income distribution. But if you want to answer this now, you can. But if not, we can continue on the third panel in the third series of questions. I will first now give the screen to Dr. Khanna, please.
Okay. So how can smaller cities begin to emerge as smart city hubs? First of all, we have to rethink what a smart city is. We tend to think of it as a very futuristic city with a lot of high-rise buildings and artificial intelligence, cities that, for example, look like Singapore or some places in Europe. But the fact of the matter is, a smart city, the new definition of it, is something that is really has the telecommunications infrastructure, and that is fundamentally the key. The internet as the first or one of the list of human rights that people have. And then the other thing that's important is that it is not only the responsibility of the government. You see, like, go to another companies that come up, you can see that they provide, through public-private partnerships, they provide the kinds of logistics optimization, telehealth, and Leah's company, they provide remote learning or skills academies. All of these elements, when they are present in a city, it is equivalent to becoming some sort of smart city. But at that point, the city also needs to have an outreach. Just like Leah said, that Miami has done something very interesting. Their leadership, their political leadership, noticed what was going on in the rest of the world. They said in the rest of the US, we are seeing that there's an opportunity with crypto and blockchain to attract founders and startups to Miami as people are moving away from the old hubs of Silicon Valley and Silicon Alley in New York. So there is on the one hand, there is this release of the old way of thinking what a smart city is and a belief that we are a smart city because we do have the telecommunications infrastructure, we do have the talent, and we have the vision. That's the first step. And it doesn't, the beauty of technology these days is it doesn't take a lot to become a smart city. As long as you have your mobile phone, you have the connectivity, you can learn wherever you are, and you can actually get telemedicine wherever you are, and you can get the insurtech to give you a financial credit wherever you are. And so the next step becomes then how do you attract people? So the reason you want to have a smart city is that the people in your community are able to get exposure to the best talent, the best ideas, to the best venture capital. And that is then reinvested back into physical infrastructure like roads and bridges. So I think that it's going to be a lot more democratized, even the idea of smart cities. It may not look like Wakanda in Black Panther, but what it will look like is that people there will have opportunities for economic mobility. And at the end of the day, that's what we want. We want people to have good healthcare, good education, and a good quality of life with economic mobility options. So I would say it's the mandate of all mayors to work with the entrepreneurs in that city to come up with a narrative, to be able to attract those connections so that there's more exchange of talent. It's a more vibrant arts and culture. And even though we think that it doesn't matter, we're all virtual, actually it does matter. We do walk into the streets. We do want a place where we can have a cafe and where we can take our children out to a good school once in a while. So we do need to have that mix of hybrid mix, because otherwise we'll be totally in the metaverse, which I don't think is a very healthy way for us to live. So I think there's an opportunity for all smaller cities to stop wondering when they'll become a smart city and say, you know what, we're already at Smart City 1.0. Now let's start advertising ourselves as such.
Thank you so much, Dr. Khanna. It is really a good point. I agree with you, especially in the part where you say internet is a new human rights. And I think I can equate that with the rights to get information and access communication. Thank you so much. Now I'm going to turn to Leah to answer the question from Dandi Rafitrandi regarding the digital talent skill gap and how education system can adjust to it.
Okay, thank you, Dandi, for the question. I guess what we are trying to do with Remote Skills Academy is exactly to close that gap, right, at the moment. But I'm also want to share the experience that we have with Princeton University. So we are doing a joint program with them last quarter, and it's called Immersive University Academy, right? So where we kind of give the modules of entrepreneurships for 3 months, and also in the same time they got a chance to have internship with us. So I have the actual working experience with us. And I think that could be one of the solution, you know, to have to join venture to have a collaboration with the academy, and also we have another collaboration with the university in Holland, which is Stenden. So we did leadership programs as well, right? So it's very possible to close the gap with collaboration with the existing academy that already running the modules, the curriculums that you are looking for in your talents, right? Yeah, I guess that's my answer, Petri.
Thank you, Leah. Dr. Khanna, do you want to comment on the gap between talent and then education system, perhaps? Because you're in Southeast Asia.
Yeah, I mean, look, I think that we need, like I said, this is the same thing. The education system is not prepared. anywhere in the world to deal with the demands that we see for talent across the world. And that is why we need these public-private partnerships. A smart city is not defined any longer by the city infrastructure or what the city provides or what the federal government provides. Actually, private players, whether they are coming in from within the city or are providing that service from outside the city, are vital parts of a smart city 2.0 strategy. So smart city 2.0 is, if you can't do it yourself because you're unprepared, you have to bring in small or big private sector players internationally to help you with preparing your talent so that they are actually, not only are they educated, but they're educated in the right fields for the emerging 21st century industries. And that is the gap we need to fill. That's really the key.
Thank you so much, Dr. Khanna, and thank you so much, Leah, for your real work on building the talent. I will give the screen now to Astrid to answer the question that is addressed to go to, please.
Thank you, Fitri. So the first question is about, you know, what are the support we've given to our driver partners during the pandemic? So as I've said before, driver partners are basically the lifeblood of Gojek, yes, especially, but also now for Tokopedia, because without the couriers, these are your instant delivery couriers, you won't get that instant commerce experience. That is unlike anywhere else in the world. That is kind of our, you know, bread and butter as an ecosystem. So yeah, we really, really supported our drivers during the COVID-19 pandemic, to the point that in 2020, you know, our executives, our leaders, took a 25% salary cut, all of us, just to, you know, pull the amount of money so that we can donate that to the drivers and all the different livelihood opportunities, all the different support that we need to give. We took that from all of us, because we know that's what's right for our driver partners during the toughest time that they have ever faced, you know, in the past decade. And also, you know, a lot of us didn't get any promotion. Merit adjustment, for example, right? Because all of that is taken for drivers on top of our budget to make sure we help them really, really strongly. So for, you know, during the pandemic, we've committed more than 260 billion rupiah. So that's almost equivalent to $18 million just for driver partners. And this consists of, you know, your healthcare provision. So anything to do with health kits, masks, sanitizers, vitamins, running the Gojek safety centers for drivers, doing vaccine educations, doing the vaccination posts and the drive-through vaccination centers operation-wise, we funded that and make sure that drivers are able to get to health centers quickly, they know how to get there, and they get vaccinated as the front line of the economy. And they were actually categorized by the government as a vital worker or as a vital category, along with other, you know, public transport service providers, or with doctors and with, you know, healthcare providers. Drivers are actually really important to make sure the economy keeps going. Other than that, we also give basic need support. So this is your staple goods, your Indonesian called sembako distribution, and then we also give a lot of food needs for their family, for their daily necessities. We also provide income assistance again. So if they they have to be temporarily inactive due to COVID-19, or they were diagnosed with COVID-19, we also give them income assistance, so to replace the income lost during when they couldn't work. That's also coming from Gojek ourselves. So all of the support we've given, you know, above and beyond, just to make sure drivers are able to stay with us and able to kind of stay resilient. And hopefully, as the situation improves now, they get to see, you know, the uptick in income. They get to see more demand coming in for the services, because now we have the e-commerce services in our ecosystem. So that's why a lot of these drivers kind of stayed with us for a very long time, because they have faith in the digital economy and its growth in the future. So that's just like how we've supported our drivers. And then your question was about the recent, I think, kind of agreement from the G20 countries, I think just reached 2 days ago, yeah, about the global corporate tax deal. Really interesting. we'll have to wait and see what that would look like for each of the G20 members, including Indonesia. and see how that would be implemented here. But regardless of what that number is, you know, GoTo is always compliant with all the regulatory requirements in Indonesia. We are an Indonesian company. We operate here and we, you know, here for the people. At the end of the day, that global corporate tax deal, you know, the spirit of it is about making sure, you know, the people at the bottom of the pyramid are able to enjoy livelihood opportunities, which is what GoTo have been doing, right? So yeah, we're looking forward to work with the Indonesian government to see how that translates, how that plays out 2023 onwards, if all plan goes well. So yeah, we'll see. But yeah, we're ready to support any kind of regulations that are able to make sure, you know, a lot of more Indonesians able to benefit and directly feel the impact of economic growth.
Thank you so much. I only have, I think, less than 10 minutes because I need to bring return the screen later to Rob to do his closing and summary. So I will combine all of this question, two questions that I will combine and I will direct to the three speakers. The first is the innovation, technological innovation that empower female. I mean, there's a specific question for GoTo to empower female driver in the time of pandemic, but we know how technology is used to empower female as well. And perhaps continuing from yesterday's session or last session about gender minorities, how would technological innovation would enables and what do you see going forward, especially when perhaps individual is replaced by artificial intelligence. So maybe that's a challenge, really. And then and the second is how do you see the potential for this question from Robert Bloom about the income distribution question. How would we see that the technology would be able to be accessed by people and they can benefit in a way that is lessen the gap from those that have the technology and those that haven't? I know those are two big questions, and I would call Dr. Kana to answer first. Thank you.
Well, look, I love the question about female empowerment. This is something very close to my heart. I have a charity in Singapore called 21st Century Girls, and we actually work exclusively on teaching girls in Singapore how to code and how to learn the basics of artificial intelligence and how to solve problems using AI. Is AI going to replace tasks? Yes. But for those who learn how to work with it, will they have an infinitely progressive career as they keep adapting and learning how to add value by standing on the shoulders of machines? Absolutely. We think we are decades away from the point where it will be so easy for AI to do strategy or have human empathy. But right now, what we need is we need all girls, half the population in any country, that have not traditionally been encouraged to go into engineering, computer science, data science, and we need them to be empowered so that they have the creative confidence to build new companies. I think this is the single most important thing. In Singapore, it is a year of the female, basically, this year. And a lot has been done to highlight women across every sector, across every age group, and across whichever position they are in terms of their career. The other important thing is that as disruption happens, you need to feel okay to switch your career. So we said in Singapore, there are many paths to your success. There are many paths to your career. So you may start in one direction and then feel automation or is coming, or you may have a better opportunity somewhere else, then you should upskill. And that is, for me, the definition of a smart city, where everybody feels there's a chance to change and adapt and have more economic and social mobility in the future. So women and their role, whether they are drivers or whether they are bank tellers or they're CEOs or investors or scientists, we must give them that opportunity to create great opportunities for themselves.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kana. I will give the screen to Leah.
Yeah, if we're talking about women and technology, I myself a woman in technology. I study IT, I used to be a web developer, and since 2011, I started Girls in Tech Indonesia, where we have we want to inspire the geek in every girl, because I'm sure there's the geek in every girl that they just need to, because the way we study technology, men and women are different, right? When I started, it's because I was inspired by something that I see, and I want to. Basically, the first thing that I built was a website when I was 13 to showcase my poetry, right? So there's something that I want to make, I'm inspired, and then I study, right? Not because I want to learn coding, right? So that's how we do it with our girls in tech. We create workshops. So they would really hands-on, right? So not only listening to us, but also try, you know, try Python, try robotic, try making podcasts, try video editing, you know, like during 2-3 hours, they really try and then walk out of the room learning something, right? Really get their hands dirty and understand that it's okay to make mistakes, because you will make a lot of mistakes when you are building something, and it's totally normal. And in here, in Bali as well, we have a hub, we have a co-working space in Sanur, we call it Live It Hub. And we created a once a month women's circle where, you know, female entrepreneurs can come, and then we talk about our challenges in running our business and everything. So in a rooftop during the sunset, so, you know, having some tea and kombucha. So everything that women love.
Yeah. Thank you. I think there's always special tips that we can do, and I think it's really encouraging. Maybe now Astrid can give advice in terms of share with us what GoTo have been doing for empowering female drivers, please.
Yeah, thanks, Fitri. So at Gojek, we've pledged our sustainability goals. So these are three zeros we want to achieve by 2030, right? Zero emissions, zero waste, and zero barriers. So the last one is very relevant when we talk about technology, because it has the power to either widen the gap or narrow the gap. Because of that gap in skills, there's a gap in access, connectivity, economic access as well. And pretty much in a lot of the places, technology is still a privilege for people, right? Especially, you know, if they're rural areas or they don't have any connectivity. So we have to make sure that technology is a force for good and kind of close that gap and make ourselves into a zero barrier platform. So this definitely applies to female drivers. While they do make a minority of driver partners, 9 out of 10 or more than 9 out of 10 are actually male. So not a lot of female drivers on our platform, just because that's just you know, how the OJEC or how the conventional drivers previously kind of structured. But yeah, we want to make sure that there's nothing there that would prevent female drivers or any of any gender, exactly, or gender minorities or any background, disabilities, for example. They're still able to access the livelihood opportunity from being drivers, as well as being merchants. There a lot more women, a lot more female business owners are in the e-commerce space and the food delivery space. So we want to make sure that they get a leg up, whether that's investment in their skills, loans, and capital financing, or the working capital financing. That would be one way to make sure the women owners of the businesses are able to scale up. For zero barriers for employees as well, we've just won the UN Women Empowerment Principles Award for transparency in our reporting, looking at how the difference of female employees and male employees in Gojek, and reporting that there's a lot of female in the managerial positions, which is quite high compared to other tech companies, including Silicon Valley. Just looking at the amount of women in Gojek, as we call ourselves Go Troops, or the workers or the employees. And going forward, we want to improve that reporting with information like gender pay gap, for example, just to make sure, again, technology becomes a zero barrier space that helps everyone, regardless of their gender, background, and their economic status or their ethnicities or any other kind of differentiators that we think is super irrelevant in the tech world.
Thank you so much, Astrid. Thank you so much for all the three speakers. You have been wonderful. I return the screen to Rob. That is, I think, want to close this very wonderful discussion. Thank you so much for organizing this.
Yes, and thank you as always, Petrie. And thank you to our esteemed panelists and participants for joining us today. We, of course, could not answer all of the great questions sent in. There were a lot of them, but we hope this is the beginning of an ongoing dialogue between Indonesia, the U.S., and the region as a whole on this topic. We also hope that you will continue to stay engaged with the Civic Forum's programming, which you can find out more about at our website, www.pacforum.org. And now that all of our speakers have finished, we have a poll for the audience. Here's the question. Will Indonesia become a regional innovation hub? Please check yes, A, no, B, or don't know, C. While we're waiting on the poll results, we would also like to ask everyone in attendance to please fill out the post-event survey. Please find the link to the survey in the chat box now. And now let's take a look at our poll results. Okay, so 93% said yes, Indonesia will become a regional innovation hub, and just 7% said that they do not know. Nobody said no. Great deal of confidence. Now, I'd like to thank all of our speakers for joining us today, our partners at CSIS and especially Petrie, as well as the U.S. Embassy Jakarta for making this event possible. We hope that we'll see you at the next event in this series. Please stay well and stay safe.
Thank you, Rob. Thank you, Fitri.
Thank you, Rob. Thank you, Leah.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Astrid. Bye. Stay healthy. Bye.